So, done, Rad. So I need that. So, the interesting bit, we'll do just a few tips. I mean, you can do week courses on cross-country flying. You can fly cross-country for years and there's still stuff to learn. So it's very, very brief. But just to give you a few of the ideas, get you on the way, and a few things that you'll need to think of. So just Bradwell and Eyam, really, that I'll focus on today. So just get your bearings again. So here's Bradwell Edge. There's Abney. Here's Eyam Edge. And so we've got Sheffield over there. So those are the sites. Hopefully lots of you flew Bradwell today, so you know that already. And you'll encounter Eyam soon. So this is Eyam. Looks nice, doesn't it? Don't be deceived. it's a pretty horrible sight, actually. It's a decent launch point for cross country, and I've had the odd occasional nice smooth evening flight. I've had the odd nice flight on there, but basically I wouldn't go there to fly for pleasure. Usually I go there to fly XC. So there's the launch point, there's the pub, and you can see how shallow it is, and that's one of your problems. And it's small, it's quite shallow, and it just seems inordinately rough. You know, there's lots of pilots had a hard time on that hill, and there have been nasty accidents on there. It is not to be trusted, and your best way to fly Eyam is to take off and get away from it as soon as you can. But it's not even that easy a sight to get away from. I mean, potentially it is cracking, because you've got a great long ridge. I mean, it might not be perfectly soarable all the way along like rush up on a good day, but there's plenty of room there. You could see it's sort of nice and flat on top there, but then it drops away into quite a deep valley there. Here you've got a bit of a dip, the ground rises and drops away into the Hope Valley there, so Hathersage is down here somewhere in the valley there, and then on the skyline you've got the Stanage Ridge there. So it's easy to be deceived and think, oh, it's a fantastic place, but it's frustrated a lot of pilots. So what's going on? So we'll, because it's such a good launch point for XC, people end up flying it in south to west southwest direction rather than going to another site. So that adds to its unpleasantness, I think, flying when the wind's off. Great top drivable in, you know, 40 meter walk to take off, couldn't be better. Long ridge, so yeah, really respect it. And yeah, if you're at the stage where you're not really confident in your glider in thermic conditions, it's not a great place to go. Depending on where you land, it's even not the official landing field's great if you can reach it, but people end up landing at the bottom of the hill, parallel to the fence and the power lines and things like that. The top landings are okay, but again, people hit walls and do all sorts of things. There's a bit of a wind shadow. So there's not many nice things about it, really. So, but that's the nice thing about Eyam. Is it's the ideal launch point, and that flight up to Filey and carrying on up to Whitby, it's been done many, many times. So if you can just get over the obstacles that it presents, it is fantastic. That's sort of the corridor bit. So it's useful to have the Upton Corridor. I have flown underneath the Upton Corridor on a day it wasn't open, but that extra 500 feet would have been nice. Be careful of if the wind's a little bit more south. You've got the bit over by Stocksbridge here, it's down to 3,500 feet, so it's tempting to be so focused on the corridor and getting around Doncaster to just clip the edge there. And a friend of mine did his first 100k flight, but he clipped that. So technically, it was invalid. Unlucky. Oops. We don't know who made this horrible infringement. They've sort of gone through the corridor, then through this and through this. And
you do know who.
I don't know who. Do I know who? Who was it?
I've already framed somebody on this.
That wasn't me. I would like to say, I don't remember, but please don't be that person. Yeah, always. I mean, if you're not confident about where you are, just spiral down and land, really. But you know, there's a high workload in cross country flying before you sort of layer on all the navigation of airspace and everything. So it's easy to make mistakes. That is one hell of a mistake. Protracted. I don't think they probably knew what was going on at all. What a pity. Look at where they landed. Fantastic. But anyway, we're chatting over break. The more homework you can do, so as you're familiar with the airspace, familiar with how it looks on your GPS screen, whatever unit you fly with, and the maps and everything, the more familiar you are, the less likely you are to make mistakes. It's dead easy to just muck up. Okay, how soarable is Eyam? The truth is not very. So, you know, it's that is part of your problem. You get there on a good XC day. It's very common. It's not, you can't even stay up. And then it starts to work, but it's not like comfortable soaring. You'll be, unless you're getting into a climb fairly quickly, you find yourself scooting over these bushes and coming back and thinking, shall I hillside land before I go down? Some people get it wrong and end up landing in these fields here. Some people try and land here. You know, it's tricky. The difference between staying up and going down is quite small. So, yeah, testing. I mentioned glider handling and confidence. Illustrated brilliant to me by Neil about 3 years ago or something. I was on my massive aspect ratio competition glide that I was flying at the time. I went down, just couldn't get in close. Neil was at the same height as me on a sensible glider, cranked it in really tight, confident in his glider, knew what he was doing. He got away, did a really good XC. By the time I packed and got back up to the hill, I missed it. It had shut down for the day. So, be confident. You know. Right, how do the thermals behave? If your cross-country flying has been from places like Bradwell and Lord's Seat and bigger sites and, you know, Weatherfell and Long Mynd, you'll be used to these big, big thermals, the size of football pitches, and you fly into this massive area lift, you think, oh, I better do a circle, and you do a circle, and you just keep going up. With Eyam, you can be in the thermal and out of it in no time at all. They're really low down, not properly formed, there's often multiple cores, and if you're expecting a big thermal, you probably won't climb. You'll end up falling out of it. So your thermal is turning as tight as you're comfortable to do to get to circle, to be turning on the core and getting out. Once they climb out, that's another thing. You can be in something, you're sort of climbing, and you're, right, I'm doing it right. And Pat said, turn tight, I'm turning tight, and I've gone up a bit, but I'm still really not hurtling up. Often you need to stick with that on Eyam. That's as good as it gets. And you fly back to the front thinking, I'll wait for something like I had last week on Bradwell. It might not happen. So you end up following something that's not much good at all. And you know, maybe it'll keep going, maybe it gets weaker, but I've seen pilots, not really low, but just circling. And you're thinking, God, I'm watching them, and I'm thinking, I wouldn't like to be where you are. And the thermals actually, it's gathered hot air from all this sort of lee side, and it's not properly triggered until almost the ground's dropping back into Hathersage, you know. So I'm not saying they're kicking the grass in the field. But there might be perhaps 1,000 foot above the terrain, but they're maintaining and maintaining and maintaining, and a bit stressful. Not suggesting that it's a great thing to do, but that's the way the thermals can be. And then it finally, all this air reaches the ground where and it can't stick to the ground any longer, and it triggers there. Another thing I've watched Neil do. True? Yes. It looked horrible from where I was. I actually got a good climb that day, unusually. So you sort of climb out, and hopefully it's got good. And then, I mean, it even gets tough. You're up here and you're watching Neil, and you're still not even relaxed. And so it's dead tempting. You've got this massive southwesterly ridge, Stanage, a few kilometres downwind, maybe off to your left. It's really, really tempting just to think, this is horrible, I'll go to Stanage. I know I can fly Stanage, it's fine. And then you'll glide off to Stanage and you'll spend the rest of the day at Stanage. And the people who stayed with the thermal that you were in have drifted and drifted and lost a bit, drifted and drifted and carried on and stopped watching the ground. They're basically, they're not being drawn to Stanage. They're thinking, right, where is the best place for my next thermal? Is there a cloud above Stanage? No. Right, okay, so it's probably not working. It's off course anyway. Oh, but there's actually a cloud over Higgertor, on the moors behind Higgertor. Use your cross-country decision-making. Don't get sucked to Stanage. And really, once you get up again there, it gets easier. You have got the crossing the north of Sheffield, the ground falls away, so that can be a bit slower, a bit trickier, can land there. But that first bit, getting away from the hill, getting that second climb somewhere after the Hope Valley, and if you've done that, you've done brilliantly, and you've got a chance now of a really, really big flight. So we said the Stanage Mag. Oh, yeah, this thing about you turn up and it's crap. It gets slightly less crap briefly, and then it goes crap again, really crap. And this is the way the weather patterns work in southwesterly winds. I don't know if you've ever looked at a chart. When the sort of where the high is when we get a southwesterly wind, it's usually a high has come across and is disappearing off into Europe. So we've got the southwesterly winds, roughly. And, of course, when a high is leaving, what's coming next? A low with fronts. So you've often got, I mean, this is actually an occluded front, but it could just as easily be a warm front. And of course, you'll know that the warm front, the effect of it, and an occluded front extends hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of miles in front of the actual what's happening on the surface. So on this chart here, you could be on Eyam, but as this is coming in, you've got the cirrus, the shading starting to come in. So it's really, really common for Eyam to be a race against time. You've maybe got an hour window, and that's your peak time. And once you're away, you stay in the good slot of air with any luck, and you keep going. And the poor souls who are left on Eyam, who didn't get that magic hour, didn't get the climb, they then are stuck there. They might get away, but they probably are not going to do the big flight that the earlier pilots had done. So the rewards are there, but there's lots to think about in terms of your timing and your thermaling and your glider handling. So, any questions on Eyam? How many people here have flown Eyam? Okay, so quite a lot here, yeah. I mean, the perfect day is turning up, having a cumulus cloud building that's drifting onto the ridge, taking off and climbing straight out. But I've gone down on good XC days, I've probably gone down 30-40% of the time. I think I am particularly crap on Eyam, but it's not easy. Well, let's talk about a slightly nicer place, Bradwell. It has its tricks in its tail, but there's Bradwell, the lower takeoff there, cement works, loose hill, ridge running around to Man, Lord Seaton Rushup, get your bearings. A typical sight on a busy XC day. Lots of gliders, people getting plucked off their feet while they're not quite ready. But it's a good sight. I think it's held the British cross-country record something like eight separate occasions, including the last but one. So it's a fantastic sight for cross-country. So west to west, northwest. You're aware of that step takeoff. Have you all flown Bradwell? Yeah? Okay, good. So that's nice, that step takeoff allows you a more comfortable takeoff in a strongish wind. I saw today it was gusting quite a lot and I saw people launching from the top, which is fine, they all did fine, but go down if you're in any way unsure. The reason I say about good sight assessment and weather assessment needed is there's lots of obstacles. You know, if you look at Bradwell, it's actually quite low in relation to the ground upwind of it. So you get lots of lee side effects. You get lee side wave, wave rotor, out of phase wave on stronger winds. So you need to be feeling what the air is doing and get advice if you're not sure, if there's not many people flying. Watch the gliders. Are they really, really looking? Are you feeling sharp gusts on takeoff? And those would be alarms. And when you actually look at the landing field, that looks nice, but you've got a village there, you've got power lines running across the bottom of the hill, you've got lots of places, you've got gorse, you can't hillside land it. And if you do get low on Bradwell, once you're sort of 100 feet below that top step, it's pretty hard to get back up again. It doesn't seem to work low down. You've probably got more chance of getting up if you just push out and get something. You know, say, well, I might well end up in the bottom field, but I've got a chance of getting up. And scratching that ridge along the gorse and trying to squeeze the glider into a space generally doesn't work all that well. Right, I have to say a bit about a gliding club, because 10 years ago, if you were flying, you will remember that it was quite a tense relationship between DSC and the gliding club. Things are radically different now. They're absolutely brilliant. And they're very keen to work with us, and that's why we're here tonight and we talk about the flying. And we had a good day today. So if you're on Bradwell today, well done. They had no complaints about today, which was nice. There were a couple of people sort of lowish on the ridge this afternoon that I saw on the gliding club part of the ridge, but they were well out in front and they weren't erratic. They were sort of going up and coming back along the ridge. They were sort of roundabout ridge height. What they weren't doing is appearing suddenly and then thermaling back over the field and then gliding forwards. You know, they were chilled. It didn't stop them launching. One of the best flights of today, pilot went right the way down the gliding club ridge to the south end and got a thermal more or less over Hooklow village. So he'd gone past the gliding field and he climbed, and there was hardly any drift on the climb at all. And he drifted right, in fact, let's go back a couple of photos. Wrong way. No, wrong way. Where am I? Back to Ian, right. He drifted, so Bradwell will be over here at 90 degrees to this ridge, and he drifted right the way over here, over to the Barrel Pub, and he got $4,000 at that point there. In fact, he was pretty much at $4,000 right over their launch point, and he's not interfering at all. The rule is if you can cross their field with more than 2,000 feet above ground level, so $3,500, you're just not going to affect them at all. So he's gone right the way south past the gliding field, he's climbed out, he's drifted sort of parallel to EM Edge, and then he's set off and he's seen all the higher moors out in front of Bradwell, and he's managed to get lift over there, and he's got all the way to Mantor and all the way back again. A great flight, and he didn't mess the gliding club up at all. So they were happy today. So well done, everyone. Right. So just back to the map. Today, they were... So north is up. So this is our part of the ridge. There's the bowl. there's their part of the ridge. They were landing and launching in that direction, weren't they? So they were doing their approaches in from there. So I suppose the pilot that climbed out from here might have just got in the way of an approach, but they weren't unduly worried. There was no conflict. More commonly, if they're landing this way, as they'll do their approach over the bowl just to the south of our launch. So that's a place not to be low. My flight today, I mean, I came late, so I was sort of flying for about 4:15. I did go down onto the ridge, but I decided not to go all the way along, because the other thing is, if they have a cable break, their get out is right, quickly swing, turn left, and dive out onto the ridge. So I sort of thought, I'm not going to hang around there just in case. So I circled around the trig point around there, thought that's not going to cause many problems, and then went back onto our ridge there. So always be aware. Look for gliders at their launch point. Work out which end is the winch. Watch them launching. Look to see if there's gliders sort of lined up at the other end of the field. You know, if you can see a two or three gliders there waiting, chances are they're going to be launching pretty soon. If there's no gliders there, then that's probably okay to cruise the length of the ridge while they turn their gliders back to the launch point. So just be aware. And, just because someone's gone down there doesn't mean it's necessarily a good idea. They might not know what they're doing, or they might know what they're doing, but you're 5 minutes later and circumstances have changed. So I think the simplest thing is say, if they're flying, just stay up here. That's the easiest solution. Okay, this is a typical climb out from Bradwell. So here's the ridge, and you've taken off and you've circled up, and almost every single time, I've done countless XCs from Bradwell. Halfway to cloud base, I lose the thermal. It goes rubbish. Happens nearly every time. I can't remember when it didn't happen. I think it's just down to that sort of little bit of a dip in the ground beforehand. As you leave over the back of Bradwell, thermal just sort of loses its energy a bit. The temptation at that point is to go blasting off downwind. Then you put yourself low. So if you can, hopefully be with other gliders, really look carefully, because chances are one of them will be still climbing. Or if there's nobody with you climbing, just do a big circle and almost certainly you'll find it again. You know, so don't panic. So you've climbed up, you might be roughly over the track where you've parked the car, you've lost the lift, just have a search round. It'll almost always be there, and you'll almost always find it again if you don't panic and either just full bar it back to the ridge or hurtle off downwind. If you've got other gliders there, it makes it a lot easier. So you've been patient, you've not panicked, you've found it again, and you've climbed all the way up to cloud base. This isn't to scale, of course, you then glide off. This would be the Grindleford Valley. So you've come off that big, high mass of ground that Bradwell's on, and the valley behind it there. And you might be quite a bit lower than that. These aren't soarable slopes, but often that valley's triggering. So that's a very good place that you get your second climb, sort of maybe a lee side of there, maybe coming up out of the valley, sometimes off the moors, but this general area, second climb. Now what happens after that is you then start, after a little while, you've got the remaining plateaus of the peaks, and then it sinks down and down and down and off into Sheffield or Dronfield or Chesterfield. And this can be hard. So this is a time to just stick with everything that you've got. The ideal way of doing it, the least stressful way of doing this, if you've climbed up to cloud base, and you just stay with your cloud as it's drifting. If it's sucking you into the cloud, just go to the downwind edge, lose a bit of height, come back underneath the cloud, get back up close to cloud base. And sometimes you can drift almost to Chesterfield without making a single decision at all, without having to make a glide. And if you've done that, you're really well set for then doing the big glide out to the M1. And the general thing is, if you start that high, you'll manage to reach the M1, and the air seems to work again when you get to M1, Bolsover and past Staveley and places like that. Where you can go wrong, particularly in stronger winds, if you've climbed up here and you think, yeah, I'm in the game, you go blasting off and it's really sinky, and you know, lots of flights. I think pilots are very good these days. I say lots of flights tend to end Drumfield, Sheffield, Chesterfield. Not so many these days, because pilots are really good at hanging on, just being patient, stay high, look for the clouds, and don't try not to do a long glide at that point. Just out of interest, here's two track logs. Me and Ash flew together on this day. Well, we were not actually directly together, but we were flying from the same site, slightly different times. Ash was there earlier, and so he got lots of little climbs early in the day before it really started to work, and gradually it improved. And then I'm not sure, I'm guessing this is the one that he eventually left on. There's where it went crap halfway to cloud base, and there he is, so that's great. And then off he went. You see his climbs and all the way down. And then this was my flight. I got there a bit late, so it was already working, so I took off. There's the crap bit halfway to cloud base, and up we went. Just looking at those two track logs, or height graphs, I should say, sorry. Anything strike you about them?
One's a lot less peaky than the other.
So what's going on there then? You're right, yeah.
You're gliding a lot. Actually staying with it. He's trying to milk every minute like this.
That's exactly, which... That's right. So Ash has used, and this is a really, really good tactic. He's used the wind really, really well. Every time he's found a bit of lift, and probably zeros as well, he's just circled and circled. I'm still going XC. Okay, I'm not gaining, but I'm still going XC, and I'm not going down. And he's used it really, really well. I've clearly ignored quite a few of those weaker climbs and just kept on gliding. So I've got lower. I've had longer glides and got lower. I haven't got the times on here, but I was probably, I don't know, from that point to Ash, I was probably an hour quicker, roughly, by the time we got towards the end of the flight. So thinking, oh, that's clever, well done, good. Making more of the day. It was a day that was shutting down. But Ash... I think Ash did over a ton that day. I didn't get to the ton. So by just using the wind and milking every little bit of lift, it was a great flight. I think the ideal is the combination of the two. It's about, actually, it's good. I can get a boot on and keep going, but it's recognizing, actually, something's changing about the air. It's spotting it. The cloud's not so good. Does it feel weaker? Is there a top cover coming in? Do I really need to try and outrace it, or do I just want to be conservative? And I do remember it because I got to my highest in the flight in this long glide, and I got another climb and across the trends, and I've never really got going again. I've struggled and I couldn't get up again. And Ash's, you know, this was Ash, he's probably taking a bit there, and he's kept himself up in that little bit higher. And where I went down, he's got up again. I'm not saying they are the same time or the same place, but it's interesting. You know, he's probably got in a bit higher and he's got up. So, interesting one on tactics. So, we've done that. Okay, yeah, actually. There is airspace out there. We know about rads. We talked about that. But there's lots of ATZs and various things that you stumble across. So you always have to have your wits against you. Scampton, that's a restricted area. Danger area. It's a danger area. It's not open all the time. not active all the time, but you need to be aware. I'll perhaps come back to that as well. But let's do ATZs first. So it's really common. You're coming up against an ATZ. So this should be ingrained in your mind. You should know this. How big is it?
2,000 feet above the ground.
Okay, so 2,000 feet above the ground, no, not above sea level. So how do you know where the ground is? Because you...
It shows it on the chart.
It does. So you'll see code numbers with the name of the ATZ. It'll give the height in thousands of feet of the... No, the height in feet of the centre of the main runway. So you add 2,000 onto that. And you said two miles...
Radius.
It's two nautical miles. So a little bit more than a mile. Of course, we work in kilometres, really. So, oh yeah, there's two different sizes. Some are two, you can see they're on the map, some are bigger than others, so the bigger ones are 2.5 nautical miles. So what would that be in kilometres? A bit more, I think you're saying, isn't it? Actually, you know, to get across the whole way across an ATZ, if you went across the fattest point of it, it's a long way. Diameter, the smaller ones over 7 kilometres, and the bigger ones 9 kilometres to go from there to there across there. So yeah, they're not insubstantial obstacles. So height, we know the height, 2,000 above ground level. So here we are. We've got to Netherthorpe. We're at the base of the corridor, 4,500 feet above mean sea level. Netherthorpe is 254 feet above sea level. What, you know, to do this 9 kilometres across Netherthorpe, what sort of glide angle are you going to need? Actually, very useful to know this. Quite a lot. Is the correct answer, yeah. Yeah, yeah, it's about 15 to 1. So even if you're at base, if you're going to go straight across the middle of it, a tailwind and a good lifty line, you'll get 15 to 1. But how often do you see 50, you know, you look at your glide angle achieved, on how often do you glide consistently at 15 to 1? Probably not very often. So it's a gamble, to say the least, to just glide straight over the top of it. You've got to be really confident that you're going to get a good line or get a climb halfway. So you could probably think, right, we've got to think of this. There's something else as well we need to think of. The classic agony thing, you're getting close to a bit of airspace like that, you glide and you know it's coming. You think, I could really do with a climb now. And you glide, and you're getting close to it, you think, I really want to climb now. And you glide, and wicked, and we get the climb. And that's, if you're in lift, as you're getting to the ATZ, you could stay in lift, that's a really nice place. You're not gliding right over the centre, you're just sort of drifting up at cloud base, so that's great. Imagine you, the positioning wasn't quite right, and you get the climb there. You can see what's going to happen. Oops. So, of course, you wouldn't do that. You have to leave your climb and fly off, and probably that'll put you down. So how can we... That problem of the 15 to 1 glide angle, the problem of that we can't actually take the thermal that's there with his beat. There's always, do you know that? There's always a big, juicy cloud just over the centre of an ATZ. It's just one of the cross-country facts of life you'll get to accept. So what we want to do... Try and hit the edge. So obviously it's a much shorter distance, and if we have a horrible glide and the height's disappearing, we can just dive off to the side and land there. So try and skirt the edges is much, much better. There won't be a cloud there, of course, and it'll be crap, but at least you can land safely. And of course, if you get a thermal, if you're look at your track on your GPS and see what's the actual drift. You know, get exactly what's the drift. If it's exactly westerly, you know if you get a thermal from that point, you can, from really low, you're going to miss the airspace. So there we go. So that's if you can go round it, it has got multiple benefits to you. Okay, so we've got to the M1. So we've got over that horrible bit at the back of Bradwell and not panicked. We've got up to cloud base. We've got to the moors just before we start crossing over down into Sheffield or Chesterfield. You've stayed with your cloud and you've drifted. And then eventually you've seen a good cloud forming over to the M1 and you've glided and you've got there and you've got back up to base again. You're doing brilliantly. It's the coast. You're on. You cannot fail. Well, other than the airspace, there's obviously lots of potential to just make a muck up at any point on the flight. So, you know, most of you have been XC already. You can do it. You can thermal, you can glide, you can find an ex-thermal. It's just a matter of stringing them together, you know, regularly. Consistency is what it's about, really. Conditions often change, particularly from if you've been a bit slow from here, you get swallowed up by the bad air. Sometimes when you're cross country, you have to move across the country in a slot of good air. And if you really, really like your rasp, sometimes you can see the best slot of air moving across the country and you can time it and think, right, I need to be there by 1 o'clock and by 2 o'clock I need to be there. It can be as clear as that. So staying in the good air, and the clouds will often give it away. And I've landed loads of times at the Trent Valley. That's a significant obstacle, really. I guess it's a bit lower lying, it's soggier, and often you can see it in the clouds. So just as you're congratulating yourself, you know, be ready that's the next hard bit. I mean, I was chatting to Chris Ashman earlier, who you might have met Chris as a relatively inexperienced and enthusiastic paraglider pilot. He's two lads fly with him as well, John and what's his other lad called? John and Joe. That's it. You know, very modest guy, multiple hang gliding cross country champion, phenomenal pilot. But even he'll say, "God, yeah, a number of times it's all gone to tears at the Trent Valley." So that's another time to be cautious. And then we mentioned Scampton, so back to, where's the air map? Been easier to come out. Okay, so get your bearings, here's Bradwell. Lincoln is there. Okay, so you've got an ATZ. You've got the Waddington here, which is you've got the ATZ, you've got the military air traffic zone around it, and you've got this restricted area around Scampton. So that is quite an obstacle as well. So what to tell you about this? ATZs, we know, you can't go in ATZs unless you've got permission from the airfield to do so on the radio and your airband qualified and all the rest of it, which not many of us are. Okay. We've got a restricted zone there. Can we go through that? Well, it's not active all the time, and on the key of your map, this map here, the 1 to 500,000 map, there's a phone number you can ring to find out if it's active. You speak to an RAF type, a Red Arrows type fella, and you try and speak their language. You know, it's a bit plummy, and you say, "Is R313 active today?" And they'll say, "Oh, no, it's not." So and you can just check. So that means the Red Arrows aren't training, and I'll be able to come through on my paraglider. And they'll say, "Yep, that's fine." So that's good. And usually, if you know, on a good westerly day, someone will have done it so often, the word will be on the hill if you talk to the well-prepared pilots. So you can go through the blue bit on some days, but not other days. So what about the brown bit? That's the military air traffic zone. Can you go through that? you are allowed to fly through. It can be busy. I have been through there midweek, and there's all sorts of stuff going on in the panhandles. So it is busy, but yeah, legally you can go through that gap there. So I think that's. Shall I come out of the box or just keep clicking? I'll keep clicking. So that's. Oh dear. It's tedious, this bit. Isn't it? Yeah, done that. That's just by way of revision, a quick refresher. Scampton. There we go. Any questions about anything I've said from Eyam or Bradwell? So hopefully you all think, well, that's dead easy. Nothing stopped me. So get out there and do it. And work in teams. Fly together. Swap phone numbers. Help each other get back to the hill. Trains are brilliant from the east of England. All routes lead to Sheffield. And, there's even a train to the Hope. To have a station to walk up. I have actually walked up a few times and got back a bit late and there was nobody there, and I haven't got many friends, you see. So, but it's doable. So it's good infrastructure. Don't put obstacles in your way. And I've also had people come out, and I've been stuck on the A1 late in the evening. People have come out and get me, but it's only because I've had their phone number and they'd forgot to turn the phone off. So, So work in teams, help each other. Thanks ever so much for coming, guys. I hope that was useful to you. And look forward to seeing you all at the coast in the next few weeks. Mint chocolate chip, actually, for me, please. Yeah. Yeah.
Thanks, Pat.
Thank you. Thank you.